श्री एन एन वोरा जी चेयरमैन इंडिया इंटरनेशनल सेंटर, श्री डी आर कार्तिकेयन प्रेसिडेंट एज केयर इंडिया, श्री एस सी गोयल वाइस प्रेसिडेंट, श्री संदीप गोयल जनरल सेक्रेटरी, डॉक्टर जे सी बात्रा प्रेसिडेंट एज केयर इंडिया एंड श्री पराशरन जी whom we are felicitating today, and my dear brothers and sisters, and also elders, we have all assembled here today, this Sunday morning, for a very auspicious function of felicitating one of our great sons of this great country, Sri Parasaran. Even my office was not aware of this marathon. Otherwise, we should have rescheduled the program also. But it has happened like that, so don't worry. Sri Parasaran ji was trying to apologize to me for the delay, but he is not the cause for delay. So, but one thing I appreciate, that all of us in our public life, and particularly the elders or the leaders, they should all adhere to the time. This is what I have learned from my grandfather and also the seniors from whom I got trained in the political life of the country. I am happy to participate in the 30th annual and Elders Day celebrations of the Aged Care India organization dedicated to the welfare of senior citizens. I am very happy to note that Aged Care India has been honoring eminent senior citizens with the Most Eminent Senior Citizen Award each year. While eminent jurist Sri Fali S. Nariman was honored last year, another illustrious senior citizen, legal luminary, jurist, scholar, and former Attorney General of India, Sri K. Parasaran ji, is being honored today. It is a fitting recognition of his exceptional contribution to the field of law and justice, as well as his extraordinary personality. Let me at the outset congratulate and convey my reverential appreciation to Sri Parasaran ji for this honor. He is an embodiment of our Indian knowledge, ethos, and culture and heritage we have inherited from our forefathers. After a brilliant academic record, Sri Parasaran ji has had an illustrious career during which he adorned the top positions of the Advocate General of Tamil Nadu, the Solicitor General of India, and the Attorney General. In recognition of his accomplishments, he was nominated in 2012 as a member of the Rajya Sabha and was decorated with the honors of Padma Bhushan and later Padma Vibhushan. Known for his erudition, discipline, hard work, honesty, and ethics, Sri Parasaran's legal canvas has been wide. With equal facility, Sri Parasaran ji, throughout his distinguished career, had handled a wide array of cases, be they serious constitutional matters or interstate water disputes. Today, at 92 years, Sri Parasaran stands tall among the entire length and breadth of India in terms of knowledge of law, knowledge of shastras, erudition and ethics, and is rightly referred to as a Pitamaha of Indian Bar. He was humorously referred to as the Super Attorney General, despite defending the government in court for decades. He did not shy away from voicing his views and disagreeing with the political leadership as and when he felt it necessary. In 1985, as Solicitor General of India, he advised the government not to act on the show cause notice issued to demolish the Indian Express building, as it was legally untenable. You just now heard from Oraji about his advice even on Bofors. When the government did not listen to him, he refused to defend the government, not about Bofors, refused to defend the government in court and withdrew from the case, Indian Express. He offered to resign, but his stature was such that not only was he was kept in office, but was made Attorney General 2 months thereafter. Having numerous cases to his credit, he has successfully handled complicated constitutional issues. He has been considered to be indispensable by several governments. His knowledge and experience is oceanic and is widely respected by the bar and the bench. Judges have recorded appreciation for his persuasive precision in his legal arguments in court on more than one occasion. For instance, in Maruram and versus Union of India, Justice Krishnayyar observed, "We must appreciatively mention that he did tersely meet point by point with persuasive precision, juristic nicety, case law erudition, and fair concession. His submissions have helped us to see the issues in perspective and focus attention on fundamentals without being sidetracked by frills and frippery. I'm delighted to share with you a quote of Justice Sahai, who observed in PMA Metropolitan versus Moran Mar Matrama, quote, "Both the learned senior counsel, Sri K. Parasaran for the appellant and Sri Foreign Nariman for the respondents, without expression of any emotion, admirable and understanding and respect for each other, with utmost congenial coolness and exemplary precision and clarity. There cannot be more eloquent testimony of the greatness of Sri Parasaranji as a legal practitioner. It is also worth noting both the illuminaries mentioned by Justice Sahai have been honored by Aged Care India. On two recent occasions, he was appointed as amicus curiae, friend of the court. One is the Manoj Narula versus Union of India, wherein he propounded the doctrine of constitutional morality. And the other is Subramanya Swami versus Union of India, the defamation case. A versatile personality, is known for his love for cricket as well as Indian religious tradition. He was appointed on the Committee for Temple Reforms by the government headed by late Madam Jayalalitaji, and was also a member of the expert committee to suggest remedial measures with regard to the alleged restoration of the idol at the famous rock shrine temple of Lord Muruga at Padal. At the age of 77, he travelled to visit the holy shrine of Kedarnath and Kailas Manasarovar. His arguments are often prepared with scriptural references and anecdotes. His spiritual faith and belief is deeply interwoven with his legal expertise. Earlier, when rival parties approached him to represent them in the Ramasetu case relating to Ramasetu Samudram project, what we call famously Setu Samudram, Sri Parasaranji chose to argue against the government and for protecting the Setu. When asked why he was opposing the government, he recalled the Kanda Purana, which describes the Setu, quote, "It is the least I can do for Rama," he told the court. Sri Parasaranji also made a mark as a member of the Rajya Sabha and always used to make meaningful and constructive suggestions while participating in debates. Everybody used to listen with rapt attention whenever he spoke. I was fortunate to be there in the house during his tenure as a member of the Rajya Sabha. He is held in high regard by everyone, not only for his knowledge and erudition, but also for his humility and generosity. It is a matter of pride for all of us that Sri Parasaranji is admired and respected internationally for his contribution to law and jurisprudence. I also have another letter from Sri Nani Falkiwala, who is an eminent jurist of Asturias. He wrote a letter. "I came back here yesterday night and would like to take the opportunity at the earliest possible to express to you my deep gratitude for your great courtesy and goodwill in permitting me to have some time yesterday to give my final reply. It is noble acts like these which make life at the bar so gracious in the living. You are the undisputed leader of the bar, not only as the Attorney General, but in the ethical values which you adhere to so conspicuously. I always like to have you as opponent. Please underline. I always like to have you as an opponent because you will state the case as high as it can possibly be put. But at the same time, never try to take an unfair or unjust advantage of the other side. I wish the other government councillor would follow your laudable example. I hope the present generation of lawyers practicing in Supreme Court, they read this letter of Parikiwala and try to follow it in their respective lives. Because what is required in the Supreme Court, in the bar, is voice, not mice, which we often hear nowadays. I'm sorry to this, say this, but I also have a little legal background and also my public life experience of 40 years, I can say it. There is a disappointment among the people on that count to some extent. And then there is another letter written by Sri V.R. Krishnayyar. Dear Parasaran, I hold you in high esteem as a great advocate who upholds truth and justice above expediency and success, as a principle of high morality and social value. Rare, very rare, is to find a man of your stature in the legal profession. Far beyond mercenary conditions of litigative success and solely guided by right, you are never merely neutral between right and wrong, but going out of your way against wrong on the side of right. This is a great quality of this great man. To be on the right side of the right, following dharma. That is what is called as ethics in our culture. And that has to be practiced by everyone. I had sent you a message yesterday and admitted to the hospital. He said, he wrote about his health. He said, God gives life to those who deserve a long life. With all my heart and soul, I wish you for a long, full of your parts and hearts, so that the world may benefit by the life of one of whose every cell is divine, and spend the cause of goodness and justice. This is what Mr. Krishnayyar wrote to Parasanji at that time. My dear friends, Parasanji embodies the ideal expressed by poet Kalidasa, who had said in the epic poem Raghuvamsam, Uruddhatvam Jarasa Vina, or the ability to constantly grow in stature without growing old. The ability to constantly grow in stature without growing old. He continues to be an ever passionate and tireless champion of causes dear to his heart. We are a civilization that has always been proud of the way we treated our elderly. We have always been given the most esteemed and respectable position in the society to our elders. That's the Indian tradition. That's the Hindu culture. That's the Bharatiya parampara. We should all continue it. Manusmriti, one of our ancient texts, has this statement, quote, if one serves the elderly with devotion, he or she is blessed with long life, sound education, fame and strength, unquote. We should take inspiration from these enabling thoughts from the past and shape societal response to the elderly. In the past, the elderly enjoyed a place of reverence. They were custodians of virtuousness, traditions, family honor and samskara and wisdom. We must build this intergenerational bond once again. We must pass on to our younger generation the heritage, the culture, the traditions, the values professed, preached and practiced by our elders. That should be part of our history also. Unfortunately, in the present day history or even our textbooks, we find very less about our culture and heritage. And secondly, there is also every need to teach the younger generation about the morals to maintain In my younger days, when I was a student, we used to have a moral science class. Now we have only science, morals are missing. I hope that we bring back it again to our educational curriculum. The new educational policy is now under discussion. I hope that this aspect, with other aspects also, are included in the new educational policy to shape the future and to guide the younger generation for a better future of theirs as well as the nation. Because I remember we used to have a craft class, which is missing. We used to have a PT class, compulsory, it's missing. And we used to have a social service class also, NSS, that also is missing. And physical fitness has become a casualty. That's why the Prime Minister has to give a call of a Fitness India. If you are physically fit, then you will be mentally alert. See, at this age, the way he argued the case, the recent case, Ayodhya case, with not only with devotion, and there may be emotion within himself, but he never created any commotion in the court. Because physical fitness and mental alertness, that makes you person a better person. That's why this yoga. And unfortunately, some people look at yoga, means Modi ji has suggested yoga. This has nothing to do. Modi ji as a Prime Minister, of course, he has rightly recommended, and the United Nations have approved it. Yoga is for your body, not for Modi. One has to understand. All these aspects of life, which were part of our life, they must be brought in again. And we must have a change of mindset among our people. Because mere legislations, mere governmental programs alone will not bring the change. You need to bring change in the attitude, in the thinking of the people. That is what is required. My dear friends and brothers and sisters, unfortunately, in spite of the Maintenance and Welfare of Parents and Senior Citizens Act, the number of cases of children abandoning their elderly parents is on the rise. Apart from abandonment, many elderly persons are also facing neglect, abuse, physical, verbal and emotional and other forms of violence. This is really unfortunate. This is completely unacceptable. There is also a need to expand geriatric healthcare facilities in our hospitals. Senior citizens have the right to barrier-free public places. They have the right to safe and quiet spaces for their peer group and intergenerational dialogue. I often feel when people call me to visit old age homes, I don't like the word old age because I know that I am also going to become one day old age. So I told my daughter who is running a home, I said, don't name it as old age and I name it as elder's home. So wherever I am going, I am suggesting the people change the old age to elder so that it gives some sort of affection and love. And taking care of the elders, you are suggesting a ministry, you are suggesting a separate department and all, okay. I have no problem, but that's for the government to consider. But what is more important is, there has to be a change of mindset in the society. That is the need of the hour. The children should feel, till the last breath, it is their duty to take care of their parents, their elders, their grandmothers, their grandfathers. The love and affection given by grandparents, you can't explain it in words. I was fortunate to have love and affection of my grandparents because unfortunately I lost my mother when I was 13 months old. I saw what is affection through my grandmother and grandparents. So the time has come now, we have to bring again that sort of a thinking among society that we should all live together. Live together and enjoy the happiness and share the happiness because the share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. Whatever you call it as Bharatiyata, Hindu, Dharma, whatever it is, some people have a problem of the name Hindu itself, they feel pretty disturbed. God bless them. Hindu is not a religion, it's a way of life that has to be understood by all of us. That is the context in which we use that word. So leaving that aside, as I was suggesting about the change of mindset, I remember when we were discussing about in this country, there is again a clamor for a new bill, new legislation whenever a problem comes. New legislation. And that Nirbhaya, unfortunate, atrocious thing happened in Delhi. I was in parliament and the discussion was on. There was a clamor for a new bill. Anything happening anywhere in the country, people demand a new bill. So they were discussing about, and then I stood up and asked chairman, I don't want to speak on this bill. I was not a member at the time. I was not the chairman. Now I am the chairman. That's a different matter. But then I said, Mr. Chairman, I just want to have one word. I said, what is required is not a new bill. Then someone from behind was murmuring, are you against the bill? I said, what is required is not merely a bill. What is required is political will, administrative skill, and the go for the kill of the social evil. This is a social evil now that has crept into our lives, of keeping parents away, or putting them in aged homes, or whatever it is. You must feel it is your duty, till the last breath of yours or theirs, to see that they are taken care of. That sort of a social behavior is in need of Dawa, which has been there earlier. This is what I suggest on this occasion. At the same time, the government has to do its responsibility, has to create facilities, provide opportunities for a happy living of senior citizens. I am glad that the government has initiated many schemes like Varishtha Pension Bhima Yojana, integrated program for senior citizens, and national program for the health care of elderly, apart from giving concessions in income tax and railways and airlines travel. Taking care of elderly is a societal responsibility. This must become the societal norm once again. Today's event celebrates the exemplary achievement of an extraordinary individual. It's a celebration of the incredible positive energy of a deeply spiritual legal practitioner who has tried to blend both dharma and nyaya. It is a celebration of the indomitable spirit of standing by truth and justice even when falsehood threatens to cloud the vision. It is the celebration of a person who demonstrates the truth behind the saying that age is not mere number. I wish many lawyers take inspiration from the life of Sri Parasaranji and his qualities and the values of professional excellence and ethical orientation he has consistently adhered to throughout his career. I appreciate the organization for rightly choosing a great person, a great son of this great country, because this felicitation is to give inspiration to others. This is nothing we going to be added to Sri Parasaranji than what he has earned already. But we are felicitating Sri Parasaranji to give inspiration to the younger generation. That is the Bharatiya Parampara. Pratibha Puraskar is a tradition of India, part of our culture. I'm happy that your organization has taken up, and many of the seniors, including 92-year-old people and all, they all have made it to come to these functions. In the advent of this television and all, people are trying to stick on to televisions and all, but you people, out of your respect to the cause, and also respect towards this great person, great son of this great country, we all made it to this function today. Thank you all. Namaskar. Jai Hind.